where are we at? We're at this whole thing about what it does. For those of you who have been watching being here and listening for the last couple of weeks, we've been sort of working through those first four chapters of The Science of Mind, which I just think are some of the most brilliant chapters about how this whole idea, what spirit is, what God is, how this whole idea operates. And honestly, I could read those first few chapters every single day, probably for the rest of my life. They are so incredible, and I absolutely love them. So we're going to move into this whole concept. There's two key concepts in this particular section. One is the principle that the universe is impersonal. So this is where we differentiate ourselves from some of the other teachings where they say, you know, you need a personal relationship. Yes, it is a personal relationship that I might have, but the thing that's on the other side is completely impersonal, and frankly doesn't really care whether I am having a personal relationship or not with it, because it's already having a personal relationship with me, whether I'm aware of it or not. So it doesn't care. It's completely irrelevant to it. And we all know what we're talking about with the word it, right? So implant whatever word you feel good with, source, God, spirit, Brahma, avatar, yourself. Really, put any word you want in around that collective unconsciousness, just so that you know what it is. Universe, I used energy for a long time. It does not care about anything. So that whole thing about, do I need to do something to make God happy? Do I need to do something to make the universe happy? If you think about it as a universe, is energy happy? Energy isn't happy, energy just is. So it just responds to whatever it is that we do. It's not about that personal relationship. If we're not conscious, this is the conscious part, this is our personal part of it. If we're not conscious, then we get whatever happens to be going around in our own head, in the world's head. We just get that. But our conscious awareness, that's the personal piece, is the interplay. I know I am consciously working now with a universal consciousness, as opposed to I'm completely ignorant. I have no idea that there is anything to work with, and I get whatever is going around. So that whole idea that it's not personal is really, in a way, freeing, because that's where that whole idea, and we talked about that last week, that's where that whole idea of choice comes in. So I'm not burdened by some God out there that says, this is the way things are done. And if you look at the Ten Commandments, the very, very first commandment actually says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. And I used to think that meant, oh, that means the Jehovah God, as opposed to the Zoroastrian God or the Buddhist God. I saw that statement as a place of separation, but in fact, it isn't. It's like, wait a second, what are you holding as your God? Is money your God? You got a problem. Is your boyfriend your God? You got a problem. Is my work my God? You got a problem. Is alcohol my God? You also have a problem, right? So do not put any other gods before me. That is your highest standard. And when you work from that place, everything falls underneath. So all the rest of this stuff is like, you know what? If you steal from somebody, chances are you're going to have a problem with feeling issues around give and take. That's going to be a bit of an issue for you if that's the way you want to run your life. That's cause and effect. Murder somebody? Probably not a good idea either. We're looking again, cause and effect. You know, you end up going to jail, probably not going to have fun back then, even worse, right? Crucifixion, all kinds of nails, you know. Anyway, we won't go into that story. We'll save that for Easter. But but the idea is that if you think about that very first principle, even in the Bible, you're looking at a concept that says there is a universe out there. Be conscious of that. If you are conscious of that and you keep that at the forefront of your mind and you understand cause and effect, then you start to sort of, everything else just kind of flows underneath that. So that's the very first thing. And Holmes says, it values each alike. Its nature is to impart, and ours is to receive. And we're humans, and so sometimes we have trouble, believe it or not, we have trouble receiving. We have trouble getting the message, right? The message comes out, and la, 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 right? We don't receive, so that's the problem. So he says, we can only know God as far as we can become God. Now that's another little blasphemy potential thing. What? Become God? Well, a part of us is. We have to be. Otherwise, we wouldn't be capable of creating all the miraculous things that we've managed to create. They're all out there. Somehow they go through that universal consciousness right through into each and every one of us, and we create, I don't know, let's just throw out insulin. Wasn't there, and then poof, it got created. It was there. Actually, the insulin was always there. It was always there. There was a principle at stake that required insulin, and it was always there. And then Banting went, you know, if we did this, we'd have insulin. It's interesting. It's all there. It's that giving and that receiving, that cycle that keeps happening. So Holmes says, it has given to all, yet we have not accepted the greater gift. So sometimes we're suspended between the giving of something and the receiving, because we know that on some level, if we really are going to receive this, we have to do something. Maybe we don't want to do that. So we back away and we make that more difficult for ourselves. And then maybe we get the message again. And then we back away and we make it more difficult once more for ourselves. But this is what it's doing. It's constantly giving. Or we just don't even see it coming, or we don't think we're worthy. This is why you want to go to a spiritual practitioner when you're in a place of good. Because maybe that feels, woo, this is really good. And then you say, it's not going to last though. Whoops, whoops. Let's just go correct that line of thinking. Why would you want to think it's not going to last? It's funny, when things are not working, people said, I knew that was going to happen. I knew that. But they don't say, when something's good and they pick up that, you know, $100 bill that happened to be on the ground, they don't say, I knew that was going to happen. Right? But we're so good at knowing the yucky stuff that's going to happen. And we re-implant that into our minds, re-implant it over and over again. And guess what? We get to have that experience because it sends us right back there. And it didn't work. And now I get to sit in my crappy life because I knew that wasn't going to happen. And now I'm in my crappy life again. Great. So much fun. So much fun. I love that. So how much of this reality that is available to us do we really want to have? How much of it do we think that we can embody? Do we think we can only embody this much? We talked about that last week, right? Or do we think we can embody this much, or this much, or maybe beyond our reach? What about that? And that's about the big possibilities for us. So he says that there's something called a dual unity. Dual unity. And that's not the same as duality. Dual unity has to do with the way the two things work together to create that whole. And what's been interesting about Ernest Holmes, I think, in terms of his teaching, is that he really did do a beautiful job of marrying the Eastern tradition and Western tradition and put them into one nice package that sort of melds and works together. So what he talks about is, he talks about law and order, and then he also talks about spontaneous choice. He talks about volition. He talks about conscious action, and he talks about automatic reaction. So we've got the love, which is just recognizing and knowing that there is that universal love. Meditation is that one practice that helps us get in contact with that bigger part of ourselves, with our consciousness, right? So we get into that zone and we recognize and hear and feel often. And if you just close your eyes right now, and you've been doing any meditation practice, if you take 3 deep breaths right now, I'm going to let you do that, and just see if you can get yourself back into that sound that we heard earlier, the song, peace within you, peace around you. And part of you, you won't be able to get right into it, but part of you is just going to automatically relax and let go. Okay, so I'm going to bring you back out of it, just so that you have a little body memory of that. That's with you every single minute of every single day, all times, to absolutely every single living creature on this planet. That little thing. And so here's the Western part, is so what do I do with that? How do I take that universal consciousness and actually do something with it? And that's why we are spiritual living. We don't just think about spiritual principles. We figure out how we activate them and use those principles to move through our body, not just sitting in a mat meditating, but to live from that place. So that now when we're in a place of, say, protest and declaration, we come with that Thich Nhat Hanh, Dalai Lama, Mahatma Gandhi energy, you know, Martin Luther King, who just had his birthday last week. We come into that space with that energy that knows, and we are active from there. Active from there. And so that is what happens. So he says it's our spontaneous recognition of these laws that allows us to use them. So until we know the law, we can't work with it. Once we know that what our thought does, we put it through our thoughts and we activate from that place, now we're working with something. So this all sounds very theoretical, and it's like, that's great, and it sounds really nice, and it makes me happy, but I need some real juice here. Where's the meat of this? How does this really work? So I'm going to give you the principle, and then I'm going to give you a story around it. And I'm just looking at the time here. Oh, good. We've got time. We're good. So first concept is it's all love. So even though it might look like it's, think about your parent in some ways, you know, I'm not doing this, and I mean the good parents, not the ones that we maybe have, you know, bigger problems with, right? The good parent says, I know this is really hard. I know you don't want to save your money. I know that that's really hard for you and you love spending your allowance every single week, all of it. And then you ask me for more because, you know, that's just so much fun. But I'm trying to tell you, no, you're going to hold back some of that money and it's for your own good. And yes, it's painful, right? So think about it from that point of view. Sometimes love and for our best doesn't necessarily feel that way until we get to have the experience and we grow from that. So we know that it is all love, it is all for growth, it is all for our evolutionary consciousness. And behind that is this law, the cause and effect law, that continues to operate. So love is the way, which is an interesting choice of words that he uses because that's a word from the Tao. The Tao is the way, right? And then love points the way. So if you think about it, if what would love do is a nice way of kind of, I'm in dissonance here. What would love do? Well, if you come up with an answer and the answer's within you, that's probably a good starting place. And now you go in that direction. Love points the way. The law makes the way possible. So here's the practical part. It works through us. So what he talks about is that we have the job of creating what he calls the mold. So have any of you done ceramics in school? Any of you put your hand up? A few of you have, okay? Well, you know the principle anyway of a mold as opposed to that ugly green stuff that, you know, you had to grow on your bread at some point in your life, right? that kind of thing. So we're talking about the other mold. So the mold is the form. And they can become incredibly complex, right? You think about some of the beautiful things, even cars, right? At a certain point, now they've got the, what are they, the three-dimensional, what's that called? You know, you make it out of plastic. 3D printers, right? So I believe, if I'm wrong, somebody can correct me, but I'm pretty sure that they start with a mold, and then it gets injected with the plastic through the printer, right? So think about a 3D printer. No? No? Okay. It doesn't work like that? Oh, it's drawn. It's on an AutoCAD or something like that. Okay, so we're way past creating the actual mold. But if you think about an AutoCAD program, it's still creating a digital mold for us to fill, okay? I need to be up to date on my technology, clearly. So here we are, we've got our construct. Let's just call it that. You guys are way ahead, so think about it in your mind then. Forget about the old-fashioned mold. You've got your construct, and you can make it really, really complex, and you can put lots of plans in place and all the rest of that, but at some point there needs to be a void, right? Otherwise it's not a construct. If you do too much over-planning, and I've been guilty of that at times in my life, what happens is you actually start moving away from being able to complete the project at hand. All you ever do is stay in plan mode. I'm just planning. I'm planning, and I'm planning, and it's still not right because there's still this, what if this happens? What if this happens? What if this happens? Oh, I better plug that hole. Oh, I gotta plug this hole. Oh, I better plug, and you know what? It's not happening. Nothing is happening. All you're doing is filling in those holes that are all still part of your consciousness and part of your imagination. Because you actually haven't created it yet, right? You've just been playing around with that mold, playing around, playing around. So the idea is that we want to create a mold, and we are continually creating molds. But the concept is we need that void space so that spirit, energy, imagination, creativity, evolution, whatever you want to call that, can fill it. And it will fill it. All the time it fills it. So I'm building my mold, and I end up filling it with, let's just call it anxiety. Let's just call it that. And I don't think I'm really filling it up with anxiety, but I am. And you know, my mold is starting to get a little ugly. A little ugly. And guess what? Spirit comes in and it just fills it so that I can manifest that ugly experience. Thank you. I did every part of that. Every part of that. I had lots of other people. I'm not saying there weren't other people around, right? But in a weird way, they all played a role in ensuring that that was an ugly experience. So here's my story. And it's an interesting one. So I think so. You can have your own opinion once you hear it. So many years ago, about 15 years ago, I was in a really uniquely fortunate position. I had a friend. I was working in a newspaper in Penticton, just a really small town daily newspaper. And one of the people, there were these big protests that were happening at the time around Oka, and so the Penticton Indian Band was getting quite involved in some stuff. And I ended up crossing paths with a reporter from CBC Radio. I'll truncate that part of the story to just say I eventually ended up working for CBC Radio as a news reporter, and the producer of the program needed to, he got seconded somewhere else for 6 months. And so he came to me and he said, would you like to take care of the program? The morning show for 6 months. I know you only work half time, so you would be required to work full time. I had a 4-year-old at that point in my life. And so it's gonna be a tall order, and yeah, you'll produce the show. I was like, okay, I knew enough that the answer is yes, right? I didn't know enough about that, so that was good. Because I'd been creating this mold in my mind since I was about 25 years old or something, that I wanted to work for CBC Radio, and it didn't seem possible, and yet all these little pieces, I never let go of it, and all these little pieces just started to theoretically magically show up. So now I'm in this beautiful flow, right? I've got my opportunity to be a producer. It's not full-time yet, but I've got the opportunity. And so the universe decides however it works, I think the universe decided through the auspices of what's called an executive director, so we'll just say executive producer. It came through this executive producer that let's just fill up that hole, 6 months, let's just fill it up and test everything we can with this person. Why not? Let's test Karin to the hilt. How much does she really, really want to be at CBC? So it looked like this. Let's create a new transmitter and put that in for CBC Radio 2, so we've got like Radio 2 not accessible to anybody in the Okanagan. Let's put that in, and Karin will be in charge of making sure everybody knows and event planning and all the kind of quasi, not the technical stuff, but a lot of stuff around that. And then we're going to find out who actually was responsible for the Air India disaster that happened in that time. And then Pierre Elliott Trudeau, let's just say he's going to die. And so he did. And so that blew apart an entire show. The Air India blew apart an entire show. Then we're going to have the brand new leader of what was then the Alliance Party. He's going to actually parachute and drive his Sea-Doo to the Okanagan and launch his leadership campaign to become prime minister. So now all the spotlight is on us here. So we'll put that in there too. So we've got like political stuff. We've got the other stuff. We've got managing other reporters. We've got international, like Air India, international disasters. And every single time any of these happen, I put a show to bed. I wake up in the morning. It's like, oh my God, there's like 4 hours of programming that just got blown up and I've got to completely do it all over again. Okay, I'm in. And so I keep going. And then like the icing on the cake is, and we're going to do this new thing called Hockey Day, Hockey City. I can't even remember. Somebody in the country gets to be the Hockey City, and then a whole bunch of money gets sent their way, and they get to Hockeyville, thank you. Okay, and so they're going to launch that too, and everybody gets to do it, and who is it going to go to? It's going to go to Nelson. Great, that's in our listenership. So now I'm doing a road trip, a remote in Nelson. And Don McLean was there, and I had to do an interview with him. I wasn't the host, but you know, I'm the producer and had to do some other stuff. So day of the remote, everybody's there, we got all our gear, we're not in our usual place, we're in Nelson. That happens to be where my mom lives, so of course my mom's going to be there, she's a big CBC listener, I'm thinking about that. All these things are going on, everybody's counting on me because I'm the producer, I'm going to make sure everything's done. And remember that anxiety mold? You got that as your backstory, right? You got that anxiety thing going on, like in my head. So that's all going on, and then what happens on that one day? I really don't know exactly what happened, but somehow that one day, my alarm did not go off. I am not kidding you. And I had not taken a sleeping pill because I didn't have any sleeping pills to take. I had not been out drinking the night before. I never did that because I was too paranoid to do that. I didn't even hear the knock on my hotel room door. And all of a sudden, I wake up. The show starts at 6. I wake up. It is 10 minutes to 6. I am like ready to puke. But I know now is not the time to puke. So I throw on everything I've got and I run downstairs. It was in the hotel lobby of the building that I'm in. And you can imagine, I'm sure, the look on my coworkers' faces. Like, what? Yeah. Right? It was an interesting day. I did the interview with Don McLean. He was very generous. He was very nice. It went well. Obviously, the concept went well because they continued to do it. But needless to say, when the end of those 6 months finished, I did not get offered a job as a producer. And in a way, I wasn't terribly surprised, go back to that mold again, because I was stretching more than I felt I could reach. I had created a mold that had limitations around it. I had not created a mold that said, if I conceive this, I can be this. I didn't allow myself to stretch beyond. And so there was another mold that was taking place, the real one that I built, and I made sure that I put those little concepts, little ideas, little niggling doubts, and I gave them the energy necessary to ensure that I did not succeed. I thought I wanted that, and I really believed that I wanted that. But the truth is that when we really want something and we know it from a place of depth, we live from that place that's so far past it. That probably would have been up at 4 o'clock in the morning, downstairs drinking coffee just to make sure that absolutely nothing was going to go wrong. That's living spiritually. I wasn't there yet. I don't know that I will ever be completely 1,000% there yet. But spiritual living is a tall order. Spiritual living is saying, yes, universe, I am so grateful for everything that you sent me right now, and I will do it justice. I will do it justice. I will receive, and I will stretch. I will grow. I will be that because I am that. So that is how it works. So I'm going to leave you with that. It's a tall order, but just keep thinking about what you are willing to embody. And if you think you can only embody this much, I challenge you to just play with those other ideas that are in your head, because they're yours for a reason, because they're yours to do. And there are no accidents, because at the same time as I tell you this, I think to myself, this is a wonderful opportunity. I get to tell you this story through the eyes of a spiritual principle. So in the grand cosmic stretching of things, it is all divinely perfect. And while in that moment I may have thought that I was supposed to be a CBC producer, part of me now knows, apparently, I was supposed to do something else. So thank you all for being here and supporting me in that vision. And have a wonderful week. Thank you.